Hello, I'm Franz Sischka, owner of SysConsult Engineering in Germany and consultant for Keysight Technologies. In this video, how to model a BJT bipolar junction transistor, we will discuss the modeling of a NPN transistor applying the Gummel-Poon model. I will share useful best practices and introduce you to a step-by-step flow to understand the model and to enable accurate and verified modeling results. The example project can be downloaded from the link you see in the upper right side of the screen. You can also find the link in the video description on YouTube. The Gummel-Poon model has been introduced in 1970 and was implemented into the circuit simulator SPICE developed by the University of California in Berkeley soon after. It is still widely used today for applications where self-heating and avalanche effects can be ignored. A nice feature of the model is that even with only 9 main parameters known, we get already a reasonable first order fit for DC and S parameters. These 9 parameters are the DC parameters saturation current IS and the current amplification BF, the external resistors at the base, the emitter and the collector, the zero bias capacitance values and the transit time TF. And their fitting is, as you can see here, already quite acceptable. By the end of this video, when we will have fitted all parameters as shown in this table, we will get a fitting as shown here. The fundamental equation of the Gummel-Poon model, the integral charge control relation, links the collector-emitter current to the total base carrier charge and to the voltages at the transistor pins. This means that the model covers the base width modulation effect, also known as the early effect. The Webster effect, what is the reduction of the collector current at high biasing. And the Kirk effect, the increased transit time at high collector currents. This simplified bipolar schematic depicts the base emitter and base collector junction diodes and the flow of the main current from the collector to the emitter. In Gummel-Poon, the diodes are each split into an ideal part with index I and a non-ideal part denoted by index N, which describes the carrier recombination effect. The diode junction capacitance are indexed by J, like junction, whereas the base collector capacitance can be distributed across the base resistance RBB to emulate the physical widths of the base. The delay effect is covered by diffusion capacitors, denoted by the leading index D like diffusion. The diffusion capacitor CDBE covers the forward transit time and CDBC the reverse transit time. The Gummel-Poon model also features a fourth pin, the substrate, for the modeling of the collector substrate capacitance. The substrate DC current, however, is not included in the model. After this general introduction to the model, let's now focus on the modeling steps themselves. For this video, I have selected demo data which best illustrate the special effects of the Gummel-Poon model and how its parameters can be determined. The modeling project has been implemented into Keysight's ICCAP software, which I will use to demonstrate the step-by-step modeling procedure. We will start with the modeling of the capacitances, followed by the estimation of the base, emitter and collector resistances. Then comes the nonlinear DC modeling in forward and reverse bias condition. An intermediate but important step will then be the verification of the model stability. We will finish with the S-parameter fitting, the final adjustment of the base resistor and the transit time modeling. Let's now begin with the CV modeling. For all three capacitances, the modeling equation is pretty much the same, with CJ, the zero bias junction capacitance value, MJ, the slope at negative DC bias, VJ, the pole of the model equation where the capacitance would become infinite, FC, the fraction of VJ for which the model applies a linear extension of the model equation to avoid the pole. To fit the capacitor parameters, I now start the modeling step all capacitors. We see the plots of all three capacitances versus their bias voltages. The measured curves are in red and the simulated ones in blue. To better demonstrate the parameter effects, I will first apply manual tuning. As explained before, I begin with CJE, the zero bias capacitance value. Then comes parameter MJE to model the slope to the left of zero bias. And finally VJE to fit the slope to the right. For the fine-tuning and also for the other two capacitance, base collector and collector substrate fitting, I now hit optimize to get this fitting. This ends the CV modeling. The DC modeling begins with an estimation of the external resistor values. For the emitter and also the collector resistor, good starting values can be obtained from the so-called flyback measurement method, which means a fairly strong current is injected into the base, while the collector is connected to a voltmeter. This voltmeter looks through the transistor and measures the voltage drop across the emitter resistor. Applying this method to our example data, we get about 1 ohm for the emitter resistance. For the collector resistor RC, the emitter and collector pins are flipped, the same measurement procedure is applied again, and we get about 4 ohm. Getting a good starting value for the base resistance, however, is a bit more challenging. Several methods have been published. A pretty reliable one is to get it from S-parameter measurements. At low frequencies, the input resistance is the chain of base resistor RBB, the input conductivity GBE and emitter resistor. The capacitance CBE can be considered an open. At infinite frequency, CBE shorts the conductance GBE and the input resistance becomes RBB plus RE. Therefore, the measured S parameters are converted to H parameters, with H11 representing the input impedance. This H11 is plotted here. From the frequency extrapolation to infinity, the intercept with the x-axis is equal to RBB plus RE. And from these intercepts we get a trace to which the RBB model equation has to be fitted as shown here. For low base current values, RBB is modeled in Gummel-Poon as a constant and equal to the parameter RB. For high base current values, it is lower and again a constant, RBM, where M stands for minimum. And the parameter IRB represents the base current of the transition region. We are now ready to start the nonlinear DC modeling. We begin with the early voltages, since they affect the base charge and therefore the whole Gummel-Poon model. This is especially true if the early voltage values are small. As depicted, the early voltage parameters represent the x-intercept of the tangents to the slopes of the output characteristic. I start the modeling step early voltages. We have to the left the reverse and to the right the forward output characteristic with swept base voltage. Both have the y-axis in log scale to better see the low current ranges for fitting the early voltages. I tune the reverse and the forward early voltages so that the slopes of both the measured in red and the simulated curves in blue match. The offset between the measured and simulated curves is due to the not yet modeled transistor amplification, and it is not important for the moment. It will be covered by the next step, the modeling of the so-called Gummel plots. And here they come. The first Gummel plot shows the log-scaled collector current versus the base emitter voltage. As shown by the simplified collector current model equation here, the model parameter IS, the saturation current, represents the y-axis intercept together with the previously extracted early voltage parameters. Parameter NF fits the slope together with the known temperature voltage VT. The beginning of the high current compression effect, the Webster effect, is covered by the parameter IKF, but we will fit it rather later, when coming back to the forward output characteristic. I apply the modeling now to a measurement in which the collector voltage is synchronized with the base, which means a base collector voltage of 0 volt. This special biasing condition excludes self-heating effects and excludes also the avalanche effect, which is the leakage current between the collector and base. We optimize both IS and NF. The next step is the Gummel plot of the base current. Here it is, with the log of base current versus base emitter voltage, the green curve. The low bias range, the so-called recombination range, is modeled by parameters ISE for the y-intercept and Ne for the slope. While the ideal base current range is a fraction of the collector current modeled by parameter Bf. In our modeling project, I first fit the recombination range with ISE and NE, and then the range of the ideal base current and parameter Bf. As before, the high current range will be fitted later. Now to the reverse Gummel plots, where the collector is grounded and the emitter is biased. We see the log of emitter current versus base collector voltage. In Gummel-Poon, the y-intercept saturation current parameter, IS, is the same as for the forward measurements and therefore already modeled. We just fit the slope of the emitter current with parameter NR in the ideal diode range. To fit the second part of the reverse Gummel plot, the base current plot, we first fit the linear range of IB with the reverse amplification BR. And then the recombination range, that is the parameters ISC and NC. The high bias or ohmic range will be fitted in the next setup. The high current modeling can become quite tedious because of the overlay of Webster effect and the external resistors. To avoid this problem, I suggest to start with the output characteristic with forced base current, because in this biasing condition, the knee current's effects are dominant over the resistor effects. In the reverse collector voltage range, we fit the reverse knee current parameter IKR and in the forward range the parameter IKF. The remaining parameters RE and RC, already estimated at the very beginning of our modeling flow, will now be fine-tuned in the forward and reverse output characteristic, but this time with forced base voltage. The left plot depicts the reverse and the right the forward output. The collector resistance affects the fitting in the high current reverse plot, but also in the forward output at deep saturation. Therefore, I select these two regions and click Optimize to get the final value for RC. To fine-tune the emitter resistance RE, we reuse these plots, but now flip the targets. And again, we let the optimizer find the best RE value. There is still a slight mismatch in the forward output characteristics in the quasi-saturation range due to the limitations of the Gummel-Poon model. I will show you now a trick how we can improve the fitting in this quasi-saturation region and still keep using the Gummel-Poon model. We know from passive components modeling that the fitting of a model can be improved when we cascade the model, and this is what we will apply now also here. Let's think of the quasi-saturation range as an overlay of two Gummel-Poon output characteristics. One instance of the model, shown in red, is the original model, while the other one is an instance of the same model, but with an additional big external collector resistance, which I call RCSAT, which brings this model instance into saturation. The overlay of both instances, shown on the right, is weighted by the instance parameter area. And here comes the fitting result. This ends the DC fitting. We have achieved a good fit in the forward Gummel plot and the beta, the forward input and output characteristics, the reverse Gummel plots and beta, the reverse input and output characteristics, and the output characteristic with forced base current. Another check at this stage is to verify the model stability against overdriven DC biasing. This ensures that the model, used later in circuit designs with any kind of DC biasing, will not explode. To make it clear, this test does not compare the simulated model against measurements, but rather verifies that for overdriven DC biasing, no currents will go infinite. We see in red the simulation result for the applied measurement ranges, and in blue the simulation result for the overdriven biasing. For both inspections, the output characteristic and also the base current versus collector voltage, all is okay. The model with the parameter values extracted thus far converges well. This brings me to the last step in our modeling flow, the high frequency parameter fitting, the base resistance, already estimated at the very beginning, and the transit time modeling. They overlay each other to some extent, and therefore I suggest from best practice experience to begin with the transit time modeling and fine-tune the base resistance as a final step afterwards. The transistor transit time corresponds roughly to the inverse transit frequency. And to get the transit frequency, we convert the de-embedded S parameters to H parameters and display H to 1, the transistor amplification, in dB versus logarithmic frequency. That is shown here in this plot for all base and collector biases. The transit frequency now is the frequency where the transistor amplification has decreased to 1. Because the transistor behaves like a one-pole low pass, we can make use of the gain bandwidth product formula shown here on the upper right. By selecting a frequency for which the slope is minus 20 dB per decade for all DC biases, we get the requested FT curve by a simple multiplication of H to 1 with that frequency. We then take the inverse of this FT curve and get the transit time TFF, which has to be fitted by the Gummel-Poon equation as shown here. For a single collector voltage, our parameter fitting problem simplifies to a single curve. In this curve, the Gummel-Poon parameter TF models the lowest value of the transit time, XTF models the endpoint at highest bias, and ITF relates to the bias current of the transition range. As mentioned, the transit time can affect the base resistance modeling. And that's why I'm doing the base resistance fine-tuning now, after the transit time modeling. To the left we see the Smith chart of S11, and to the right the endpoints of the traces extrapolated to infinite frequency, which is the curve of RBB. Usually, a little fine optimization provides a nice fit. To verify the fitting of our model, the measured and simulated S parameters are converted to Y parameters and inspected applying a simplified AC schematic of the bipolar transistor, with series resistors omitted, as shown here. The plots show a good AC fitting of the base emitter capacitance, the base collector capacitance, the amplification GM and the delay tau. Also the FT and H to 1. The power and voltage gain plots show a good fit. This ends my Gummel-Poon modeling demo, and I saved the modeling netlist including the fitted parameter values. Thanks for watching this video about Gummel-Poon transistor modeling from DC to S parameters. We covered how to convert the measurement data into modeling plots in which the parameters of interest are most dominant. And I showed you a sequence of model parameter extractions, the so-called modeling flow, which is important to obtain a good model with a minimum of effort. You are invited to download the ICCAP model file used in this video example, together with a how to use and also a technical description. And please don't hesitate to contact Keysight Technologies for more information. Thank you.